Feels good to be moving. It feels good to be in motion. It feels good to be water. It doesn't mean that you have achieved this ideal of perfection. It just means that you have submitted to order. You've submitted to the will of order over the will of yourself. You submitted to the will of the whole, the entirety, beyond the will of your illusion of seclusion. What do you serve? What do you submit to? Do you submit to anything? Are you the creator of the sacred trees? Are you consciousness? Are you perception? A History of Ethiopia, Abyssinia, Nubia, and Abyssinia, Volume 1, E.A. Wallace Budge. I just wanted to get a piece out of this as we continue in our investigation of Prester John. This is part 13. Oh! And don't it feel good to be water? You know, just flow. A History of Ethiopia. Now check it out. This, the first volume of Sir E.A. Wallace Budge's The History of Ethiopia, Abyssinia, and Nubia, first published in 1928, presents an account of Ethiopian history from the earliest legendary mythic records up until the death of King Lebna Dengo in 1540. Now everybody respects this researcher, this scholar, E.A. Wallace Budge. Even in that work, we always got to just get the babies out the bathwater. But wow, I mean. So we have this mention of this Lebna Dengo, king in 1540. So that this work, the History of Ethiopia, Abyssinia, and Nubia, that we're getting into a little bit of the preface, presents an account of Ethiopian history from the earliest legendary and mythic records up until the death of King Lebna Dengo in 1540. These dates and these time shifts are very interesting. Remember our parallel timelines. And in this, they kick that there's been three major shifts. And they go back to 333, 1053, and 1778. I can only assume we're talking about the years of the shift. And the interesting thing is that this 1778, when you go back to their 1053, is about 720 years. 725 to be exact. And then that 1053 back to that 333 is 720 years again. Does this 720 have anything to do with anything? Of course it does. It's mathematics. 7 plus 2 is 9. So now we're talking 9s. What's going on with the parallel times in history? Lebna Dengo, 1540. Now we got into the last drop. We already went there. Who said it's Prester John, King David? Are we still talking about King David? Or are we also adding Genghis Khan, the Genghis Chan, Cham, Chan, Ham? And how does the Ham Chan play in that scenario? So I guess in that scenario, in that wave, I mean, just lay back and surf the wave. We're just surfing the wave. When we say Cham and Ham, when we get back into just talking about Khan as a title of lord or prince or nobility. How do we separate Khan the title from just the Cham Ham scenario, when we can see that even our Israelite kings were being called Khan? So in that scenario, we're not calling our Khan, our Israelite kings Khan, or we're not calling them Cham and Ham, are we? So we're seeing a more of a definition of sorts. When we talk about the nobility and the title of prince, and what they're calling lord, king, nagus, negus, naga. Then we're going to get back into the serpent, because again, we have to, you know, look at these things, look at the serpent, even, you know, make sure we're not looking at through no other perspective, nobody else's eyes. So if we're given, you see, you know, we just ask simple questions. We say, we're given a version of the serpent in Christianity as the devil, as this trickery devil situation. And then we can read in books like the OSB where Osiris is saying he's setting up a straw man. He's setting up the serpent like a straw man, so that you're not even asking who really put this stuff together. You're just focused on the serpent. And what's really going on with Moses' staff turning into a serpent? So what is our perspective? This is the first volume, right? So this is going back to King Lebna Dangle in 1540. And I said, well, since we have a separate source here with Elaine Sekel, lost the land of Prester John, calling Prester John, living in a tent, Lebna Dango Dawit. So here we see the Dawit thrown on there. Here we see King Lebna Dango. Now just put the David in there. Put the Dawit. Put the David. Dawit is David. Dawit is David. As we keep reading, but his Portuguese contemporary simplified it to David. The Moors and Abyssinians call him Emperor and not Prester John. So all the Moors and Abyssinians just know him as Emperor. King, Emperor, King. Young David, like his namesake and alleged ancestor. So they're saying, well, word on the street is that he's the actual ancestor of David. Lebna Dangle, at the age of 17, had buckled on his sword. You know what I'm saying? Went in. Alright, so. Alright. E.A. Wallace Budge, Mythical Records, up until the death of King Lebna Dangle. Lebna Dangle, David, Dawit. So we're talking about how our timelines are playing in with this King David, King Solomon situation. The takedown of Prester John, who of course is not, you know, he's called that by Europeans, right? Otherwise known as Lebna Dangle. He's also known as Raja Chola, Raja Haraja Chola II, Jaredon. How does this all play? So let's go. Because, you know, here we call him Raja Haraja Chola II, Jaredon, Emperor of Soli, Prester John Pandian. And I say, well, how can we get back into this Pandian? What is this Pandian all about? We come over here, Pandian Dynasty. You know, we're just going to surf the wave on Wiki, see what we can get some, you know, high premium H2O, some high quality water. You know, even in Wikipedia, somebody's going to drop something. You got to get the babies out. The Pandian or Pandian or Panyan dynasty was an ancient Tamil dynasty. Alright, okay. One of the three Tamil dynasties. Interesting. Let's click on Tamil dynasty. You know, y'all can look deeper into this, but this is kind of where we're headed. The region of Tamil Nadu in the southeast of modern India. So we're talking about modern India, the region of Tamil Nadu in the southeast of modern India shows evidence of having had continuous human habitation from 15,000 BC to 10,000 BC. Okay. Throughout its history, spanning the early Upper Paleolithic Age to modern times, this region has coexisted with various external cultures. The Tamil region has remained independent of external occupation. Interesting. So there's spots that are still independent from external occupation. I wonder why. Now let's look at these three ancient Tamil empires. Alright, so we have the Chera, the Chola, and Pandya were of ancient origins. The Chera, Chola, Pandya. Trust me, it all plays when we're talking about Prestigeon of the Three Indias. All this plays when we talk about Prestigeon of the Three Indias. Why? It's just like we got right here. In the Lost Tribes and Promised Lands by Rudolph Sanders. Three Indias. The latter concept became a standard one in the Middle Ages. This was a standard understanding. What we're kicking and understanding right now was standard then. Why was all your history projected into the past from the Middle Ages? Meaning that what they're calling the Middle Ages or medieval times, they always label you evil when you're ruling. So we're talking about your rulership, the kingdoms that were taken out via the Dumb Diverses 1452 Papal Bull. These were the kingdoms, people. This is who you are. This is what we're uncovering. And they're hiding it in names like Prestigeon. In India. So when I say India, that sounds foreign to you, right, American? But does this sound foreign when we talk about one of the three Indias face Ethiopia, according to Pseudo Abdias? The second face Persia, and listen up, Negro. The third occupied the ends of the earth, between the ocean and the rim of darkness. The third became especially fruitful for the geographical imagination. The region of untold islands. Listen up, so-called African American. The region of untold islands in which the plural term Indias, etymologically one and the same as Indies. Oh, my people's in the Indies. Conquer the people of the Indies. Y'all making me do this, man. Because we got to do all this in real time. We got to do it like we never done it before, man. Every time we got to do it like it's our first time or what's it for? If we don't do it like someone's never heard this before, then we're just trying to do our own independent way. And this is not our own independent wave. This is a wave for all of Hayes' children. So we do it like it's the first time. And that keeps it fresh. There's always babies in the bathwater. Indies. What do we mean, Indies? The third became especially fruitful for the geographical imagination, the region of untold islands in which the plural term Indias, etymologically one, and the same as Indies, came to rest for once and for all. So we're just talking about India. We're just talking about the third India, because there's three Indias, and the third is especially fruitful for geographical imagination, untold islands. The third one occupies the ends of the earth. They just found you. They thought they would fall off, because they knew they weren't spinning on the ball, and they thought they would fall off. And you're at the ends, Negro, so-called Negro. So-called Anasazi. So-called Negus, kings, queens, Indias, Indies. Why is that significant? Because of this Papal Bull, Dumb Diverses, in June 18, 1452. Love to Lex Will for shining so much great light on this, man. In which they're calling you Saracens and pagans because you're against this Christ, this hijack that they are introducing. So what they say is, along with sanctifying the seizure, the stealing, thou shalt not steal, screw the Ten Commandments, screw your Creator, we'll give you a hijack. We'll give you Christus, Krishna, Buddha, Brahma. We'll give you Thoth, along with sanctifying the seizure of non-Christian lands. Non-Christian lands. So when they found you here, just like Martin Luther King said, the Negro is now a slave on his own land. He's now a captive on his own land. You're now a captive on your own land. Frederick Douglass said, the native land of the African American or the Negro is America. They all told you you're here, that they found you here, and they enslaved you here on your own land. Why? Because you were not Christians. Because you connected to your Creator with nothing in between it, no hijack allowed. Just you and your commandments, basic law, basic not killing and stealing, basic stuff, not religion, but basic stuff, not killing and stealing and vibrating with your Creator, man, of your trees, man. Along with sanctifying the seizure of non-Christian lands and encourage the enslavement of native, who, Negro? Native, what? African American, native, black, no, native, non-Christian, who are you? My brothers and sisters, you are native non-Christians. You are indigenous non-Christians. Or else they would not have rolled up on you if you were. So you are the indigenous non-Christian peoples. What they're saying in Africa and the New World. So they say we're going to roll up on all of the indigenous, all of the seeds of the Creator in what they're calling Africa and what they're calling the New World. Now, is this actually called Africa? No. Have we seen it called Erebinia? Yes. Is this actually the New World? No. Is it new to them? Yes. We, weighing all and singular the premises with due meditation, and noting that since we had formerly by other letters and hours granted among other things free and ample faculty to the aforesaid King Alfonso to invade, search out, capture, vanquish, and subdue all niggas, Saracens, and what we're calling pagans because they're non-Christian people. So we'll call them pagans. We call them heathens. Whatsoever and other enemies of our Christ that we are introducing to their non-Christian land. And other enemies of this Christus. Zeus, Jesus, Zeus, Jesus, Jesus, Zeus. Wheresoever placed. And the kingdoms. What kingdom? What kingdom? I mean, are we talking the kingdom of Prester John? Are we just talking about the kingdom of Prester John? Subdue all Saracens and pagans whatsoever, and other enemies of Christ, whosoever, wheresoever placed, and the kingdoms, dukedoms, principalities. All right, principalities, and that's your energy. Dominions, everything you possess, oh, and your possessions, and all movable and immovable goods, so-called Negro. They took your movable goods and your immovable goods. They invaded you and called themselves American. They invaded you and called themselves American. But the funny thing is that when we go into the 1828 Webster Dictionary, and look up the title, the definition of American. Con. Con. A native of America, originally applied to the aboriginals or copper-colored races. Originally applied to the aboriginals or copper-colored races. Originally applied to the indigenous people, the copper-colored races. Found here. What? Found here. They found you here. They didn't take you from Africa, man. Don't be a fool. Don't believe the hype. Don't believe their his story. They found you here, copper-colored races. You are America. American is your title. Because it was applied to you. Not that you called yourself that. But surely it was applied to you before it became applied to them. But now applied to the descendants of Europeans born in America. Okay. So if you are someone, if you're from the other world and you're born in America, then you're an American. But you, Negro, being from here, have no rights because you're called black and African American. Once they put the African on your title, you're no longer American. Now the Europeans born here are more American than you because you've accepted a title that they created in the 70s called African American. You've accepted black. Oh, excuse me. I go crazy sometimes. You've accepted black. Black. Is that not even in the dictionary? Black. Okay, here we go. You've accepted black, which means you have no light of the color of night, destitute of light. You have no light. You're just dark. You're sullen. As the heavens black with clouds, atrociously wicked. This is what you call yourselves, my people. Come up out of her. You call yourselves every time black power. Black power, atrociously wicked power, atrociously wicked power. Black lives matter, atrociously wicked lives matter, atrociously wicked lives matter. Horrible lives matter, deed or crime, criminals matter. That's why the police line up against you. They say no atrociously wicked, horrible criminals don't matter. Yes, we do. We're black. You're cursing yourself. Now they say a Negro. How does a Negro get correlated to all this horrible, atrociously wicked, destitute of light, darkness? Black ball. To make black. Black act, which makes it felony to appear armed. Man, all this stuff is wicked. So when you say black, When they simply called you what? American. So, you know, sometimes I gotta go there like it's the first time. They simply called you the copper color race because they found you here. So when we're talking about who they found here, they found the copper color race. Who they're calling Saracens and Pagans, they're talking about you. Who we're talking about here? What did they do to you? They took your movable and immovable goods, whatsoever held and possessed by them, whatever you had, and to reduce their persons to perpetual slavery. Perpetual forever. Perpetual forever slavery. And to apply and appropriate to himself, who's himself? King Alfonso, the hijack. So to apply to the hijack and his successors, whoever comes after the hijack, the kingdoms, what kingdom? The kingdom of Prester John. The kingdom of Preston Don. El Preste Juan, Emperador de la Abyssinias. Preston John, man, we just talking about Preston John. This is who they took out with what document? This document. They took his movable and immovable goods, reduced his people to perpetual, forever slavery, and to apply and appropriate to himself and his successors the kingdoms, dukedoms, counties, principalities, dominions, possessions, and goods, and to convert them. Who? To convert this king's people, you so-called Negro. Remember, the book Lost Tribes and Promised Land said that this Preston John is the last noble image of the Negro. It says that this Negro is your last noble image. Look at it. Take it in. It's your last image. Take it in. What did they take from you? What have they done? This is your last noble image. Copper color race. This is the color of copper. This is an American. Found here by the Europeans. What did they do when they found him here? They reduced his people to perpetual slavery, and they applied to themselves and their successors the kingdoms, dukedoms, counties, principalities, dominions, possessions, and goods, and converted them to his or her profit or their use and profit by having secured the said faculty, the said King Alfonso, or by his authority, the aforesaid Infante, justly and lawfully has acquired and possessed you, and doth possesses these islands, lands, harbors, and seas, and they do of right belong and pertain to the said King Alfonso and his successors. These islands, the Dumb Diverses, the original joint says the Indies and the people of the Indies. And we go back and we say, what do you mean the people of the Indies? Which one? The Indies, the three Indias. The third occupied the ends of the earth between the ocean and the realm of darkness. The third became especially fruitful for the geographical imagination, the region of untold islands. Remember Preston John's region, this especially fruitful imagination, this myth. You're talking about the Garden of Eden. You're talking about the Fountain of Youth. We're saying, oh, did a black man, not a black man, but an indigenous man discover the Fountain of Youth? El Preston John. And who are these Abyssinios? So we're going to jump back, you know, into this history, get back into the Raja Haraja Cholas, get back into the Pandians, and then to the Tamil, to the Nadu, to the Tamil, to the Nadu. All right, so sometimes we just got to go there, people. All right. So the three ancient Tamil empires of Chera, Chola, and Pandya were of ancient origins. Together they ruled over this land with a unique culture and language, contributing to the growth of some of the oldest extant literature in the world. They have extensive maritime trade contacts with the Roman Empire. These three dynasties were in struggle, constant struggle with each other. Alright, so there was beef and struggle in the ranks, with each other vying for hegemony over the land. Invasions by the Calabras is said to be during the 3rd century. So we're back at that 300 AD mark, or, you know, 200, 300 AD. This is where parallel times in history. You know, let's just get this one more time.
Astronomically, which one is valid? So, take, for example, Thucydides' Peloponnesian Wars. There are three eclipses mentioned in the Peloponnesian Wars, and they're described with great fullness. There's a lunar eclipse, an annular solar eclipse, and another lunar eclipse. You can infer what the path of totality was and the whole deal from these descriptions. The creators of modern chronology, namely Scaliger and Batavius, trying to astronomically solve the problem of those eclipses, were not able to do it without leaving out some of the data provided by Thucydides, who, by the way, says he was a personal witness of this. So what Fomenko did, he said, let's make no presuppositions about this. Where are the exact astronomical solutions for this triad of eclipses? And they turn out, there turns out to be one in the 11th century A.D. and one in the 12th century A.D. and no others. So what Fomenko does quite regularly is he will appeal to astronomical arguments to try to determine which is the principal one, and his conclusion, and however crazy it may sound, is extraordinarily well argued, is that the only legitimate history is the modern history from about 300 on, and most of that, by the way, is from 900 on. From 300 on, we got statuary documents and some things like that.
He thinks most of the things that we think of as historical events really did happen, but the question is when and where, and maybe, of course, how many times, and he thinks, well, it didn't happen 10 times, it only happened once. And most of that stuff happened after 900.
Yeah. By the way, and something we need to find out more about, Fomenko applies his statistical methods.
That's all I need. We got to keep the repetition going. We got to do it like it's our first time, people. All right, that's when we get into this time shift thing. So they said 300 AD. So then we get back into this Chola Pandya. All right, so it's third century business. So I'm going to go fast. So we got three different joints. So we got the Chola history. Let's go on the Cholas, because they call him what? Raja Haraja Chola the second, Jadaran, Emperor of Soli, Salima, Prestigeon, across from the Sambenya, Pandyan. Come on, man. I can't make this shit up. It's too good. Y'all see, this is getting good. This is getting good to me now, man. Let's go. Raja Haraja. So, when you hear about this Raja Haraja, we're only talking about Prestigeon, alright? And love to everybody sending all these links in, man. This is where, you know, this is energizing me, energizing us, so thank you. Alright, man. The Chola Dynasty. So we're in the Cholas. So when we talk Cholas, we're specifically talking Prestigeon, Israelite King, King David. Alright. Which we'll get into like we got into. We're also talking the Khan, the Great Khan. Come on. The Chola Dynasty was one of the longest ruling dynasties in the history of southern India. The earliest datable references to this Tamil dynasty. So the Chola is a part of the Tamil dynasty. Remember that. Are in inscriptions from 3rd century BCE left in Ashoka and the Mara Empire. So the Tamil, so let's get that back. The earliest datable references to this Tamil dynasty, the Chola dynasty, are in inscriptions from the 3rd century BC, left by Ashoka and Mara Empire, one of the three crowned kings. Remember the Magi, the three Magi. Al Prestigeon was a descendant of the three Magi. So now we have one of the three crowned kings of Tamilakam. The dynasty continued to govern over varying territory until the 13th century CE. Oh, shit. Why does it keep coming back down to the 1200s, man? Then the dude just kicked after 900s is when everything got legit. It doesn't mean nothing happened before that, but the history we've been given, all that BC shit, all the stuff they have documents, all that stuff in history, based on these timelines and how they've been matching up. You're talking what they're calling medieval times. You're talking 1200s. So did you have an Israelite kingdom with an Israelite king? Did you have a nation rocking here in the 1200s that was just taken out, either in the 1200s or maybe began the takeout in the 1200s up until the 14, 1500s? Is that what we're saying? Okay, let's go. All right, 13th century. So the heartland of the Cholas was the fertile valley of the Kaveri River. But they ruled a significantly larger area at the height of their power from the later half of the 9th century. Okay, the 900s till the beginning of the 13th century is when they had the height of their power. Who is Prester John? The whole country south of Tungabhadra was united and held as one state for a period of 2 centuries and more. So if the whole country was united under this dynasty, under this Israelite dynasty, right? Okay, under Rajaraja Chola I. And his successors, Rajendra Chola I, Rajaraja Chola, Virajendra Chola, and Kulathunga Chola I. These are just titles, people. Remember how they change your titles and your places and times. The dynasty became a military, economic, and cultural power in South Asia and Southeast Asia. The power of the new empire was proclaimed to be the Eastern world. The power of the new empire was proclaimed to the Eastern world by the expedition to the Ganges, which Rajendra Chola I undertook, and by the naval raids on the cities in the maritime empire of Srivijaya, as well as by the repeated embassies to China. The Chola fleet represented the zenith of ancient India sea power. I mean, we would never even look into this Raja Chola dynasties, Tamil dynasties, if it wasn't for the link between Rajaraja and Prester John, man. Which will connect to the Indians, which goes back into the last noble image of the Negro. And they're calling you Indians right in your face. And he's the king of the three Indias. And it's an Israelite kingdom. Remember, Columbus brought a Hebrew interpreter here to have a conversation with him. They said perhaps this Columbus thought that this great Khan that Marco Polo had reported on was the Israelite king who lived across the river from Prester John. Or they could be the same people. Rajaraja Chola II is Prester John. So clearly, this is a lineage. We're talking about Prester John's pops. So now we're talking about Rajaraja I. Alright. You got Rajaraja Chola. Where's the first one? Alright, his successor Rajendra Chola I. So these are all these Cholas, these Cholas, these Cholas. And you got Rajaraja Chola. The power of the new empire was proclaimed to the Eastern world by the expedition to the Ganges, which Rajendra Chola I undertook, and by the naval raids on the cities of the maritime emperor of Srivijaya, as well as the repeated embassies to China, the Chola fleet represented the zenith of ancient Indian or indigenous sea power. During the period 1010 to 1200, the Chola territory stretched from the islands of Maldives, in the south to as far north as the banks of Godavari River in Andhra Pradesh. Rajaraja Chola conquered peninsular South India annexed part of which is now Sri Lanka. So the Cholas conquered Sri Lanka and occupied the islands of the Maldives. Rajendra Chola sent a victorious expedition to North India. Alright, so they're taking over what? Are they taking over the Aryan hijack? Not the original Aryan. The Euro-Aryan. I mean, now we gotta get into the history of these Indians. And what were they fighting for? They were clearly fighting a hijack. As indigenous people. Rajendra Chola sent a victorious expedition to North India that touched the river Ganges and defeated the Pala ruler of Palaputra, Mahapala. So that ruler must have been connected to some hijack. He also successfully invaded cities of Sriwijaya and Malaysia and Indonesia. The Chola dynasty went into decline at the beginning of the 12th century. See, anything that went to decline in the 12th century, you know, was taken out by the so-called European hijack. And even before that, you know what I'm saying, we have, you know, these other hijacks as well. So when we get into this Khan situation, the Great Khan situation, it seems to be like there's good cons and bad cons. You see pros and cons. But, you know, there's Khans, and then there was a, you know, hijacks or Mongolian families that were, you know, at war with, you know, other Mongolian, you know, families, basically. So, remember, we had a, I'm going to pull it up right quick. My sister, M.A. Truth, man. Love to M.A. Truth. She does such great research, man. Love to the sister Jazz as well. You know what I mean? Check out Jazz at 432. So many sisters, man. They just are just such, you know, Darlene Ray. Man, you know, Kaya. I always try to say it right. All kind of, you know, just great influences, man. Yeah, man, let me get to one of these comments, man. Let's go into it. It make true, got the drop. Oh, by the way, you know, and this is well-known shit, but, you know, YouTube does not show, once you start dropping, whatever it is, they put this algorithm and stuff in here, man. So, you know, some of my, you know, statistical peoples, you know, definitely let me know that the analytics are crazy. Like, you know, that I'm only seeing personally, I'm only seeing about 10% of my analytics in terms of whatever numbers, you know, who cares, but in terms of the comments, though, that's what I do care about. I'm only probably seeing 5% of my comments right now. Days have gone by, you know, without me getting comments, man. So if you left any comments in the last couple of days or so that I didn't get, or, you know, whatever, you know what I'm saying, blame it on YouTube, man. They delete all these, you know, that's why I can't wait to get set up on our own framework. You know what I'm saying? That's what we need, you know, so. You know, love to everybody, man. Carlos Aguilar, man. I really appreciate all the information I get when I go to this channel. Hey, hey. All right. Got some questions about Monk Smile. M.A. Truth. This is what I want to get right quick. Oh, Shawnee Evans. Love to, you know what I'm saying? Just wonderful family out there. All the sky. You already know. Evan Reed. You already know. All right. So the sister says, whoa, I put that Yaliyatashi now. You know, if you go back to the previous drop, you know what she's talking about. Into the search engine and all kinds of German popped up. I know, it's crazy. OMG. So much drop. As always, King Drop. Outstanding and masterful accumulation of data research. All praise to Creative Sister. We're doing this together. Hey, hey, and praise to the Most High for providing you the energy to do this work. She said she found this link referring to the Caryat. So the Caryat is the other, when I say Mongol against Mongol, I ain't just making this shit up. All right, so when we connect Prester John to the Khan, and then we say, well, which Mongol is he? Clearly, they've thrown the Mongol title all around like every other title. So there are Mongol titles, you know, under the Mongol title is hidden us. Under certain, you know what I'm saying? These things, these are blanket general things. So this Caryat also pulled up in relation to our Prestigeon search. And this is what the Sister M.A. Truth is providing. This is a book called Genghis Khan, His Conquest, His Empire, His Legacy by Frank McLean. And let's read, let's read what the sister, dropped on it. Perhaps surprisingly, given his genocidal record with the Tartars and Merkit, Temujin, this is another name they were calling Genghis Khan, Temujin, did not order a general massacre of the Kariat aristocracy. He knew many of them personally. So he knew them personally. Why? Because a lot of them were family. All right. And both sides accepted that the conflict had been unnecessarily a product of Ilkhan's pride and ambition and Toghrul's weakness. All right. Okay. Toghrul. I gotta get this. And Pooba. Hey, Grand Pooba, come out to play. Got the drop on the toggle. Remember, we got this from this great blog, Grand Pooba. Some of these blogs, when we feature them, they just disappear. So you already know. So love to the ones that are still surfing the wave, that aren't just saying, man, I'm gonna take my shit down. This is too hot. I gotta go. All right, Genghis Khan, right? Genghis Khan's foster father, Ong Kong, as Prestigeon. So this particular researcher is calling Prestigeon the foster father of Genghis Khan. Not the father of him, but foster. So perhaps there's a theory of this hijacking of Genghis Khan into the family of the princes, the Khans. So he's taking the title. So this is the bad Mongol against the good Mongol, as far as the title's concerned. But we're only talking about, the seeds of the creator. We're talking about the indigenous. We're talking about the seeds of Adam. Alright. But this Toghrul. Kariat. Wow. Look at that. Okay. Let's go. So here it says, Prestigeon was the object of a conquest, firing the imaginations of generations of adventurers, always remaining tantalizingly out of reach. In the 12th century, the Mongols, right, just the title, these Tartars, Asiatics, Mongols, all that is all, thrown around, Vikings, it's like, oh, Vikings, then you get like the RFG Chosen One say, the Vikings, it's just a five and a 5-1, six, VI. VI is six in the Roman numerals. So we're just talking about the six kings, six host kings, shepherd kings, the Mongols. Then living in the valley of Anan, were very much a junior tribe amongst the nations of the eastern slope. So this was just a junior tribe. So we look at the Mongols like it's the whole thing, and we're just talking about a junior tribe. Here we're talking about the Cholas and the Tamil dynasty. So these might be the bigger tribes that we are now referring to as Mongols. Their overlords were the Naiman. So we've got to research the Naiman of the northern slopes of Altai, who may have been a Turkic tribe. So we have these Turks coming in, hijacks. Though the name Naiman is Mongolian, the major competitors in the other Naiman of the Naiman were the Kariat. So we got the same Kariat, as the sister M.A. Truth is dropping us, the Kariat. So this is why it's important, man. See how we surfing the wave together. So we got the Kariat of the Oregon and Tula. Remember the Mayan and the whole Papu Bull and the whole Annals of the Coxsackievals. They say it, oh, when we arrive from Tula. Is this the same Tula that we're getting in the Papa Book, in the Annals of the Coxsackievals? As we get into this Kariat, that is these, here's our theory that these are all the same. This Kariat, these group of Kariat Mongols are Israelites, which are the Davidic King David line, possibly of King David himself. We'll get into it. We got into it. We're going to get back into it. So the major competitors of the Naaman were the Carians. So the Naaman were enemies of the Carian, which connects to this Raja here, Raja, these Cholas, this Prestigeon. Tool of Valleys, whose rank and file were possibly Mongol, but while whose rulers were possibly Turkic. Alright. And along, so the Carian, so the major competitors were the Naaman. So we're talking about the Naaman. The Naaman's rulers were possibly Turkic, along with the Mongols. Along with the Mongols, the underdog positions were occupied by the Merkids, a forest people south of Baikal. A forest people. Don't you yearn for your trees, right? So-called Negro, they have lots of ways of talking about you, but until you understand that these trees are for you, this bud's for you, you're the forest people. So a forest people south of Baikal, and the Tartars, Merkit allies of the Beor-Nor region. So these are Merkit allies. All right, so we had Tartars as our allies. I'm sure there were other Tartar, that weren't. We're just talking about areas, Tartaria, Asia, Mozaka, Moscow, Moses, Mexica languages, Peru. So let's get into this toggle right quick. So the genetic lines between the tribes were blurry. So this is what we got to pay attention to. This is what this researcher is saying. We got to research this, all right? The genetic lines between the tribes were blurry, and so were the alliances. Yesugye, Temujin's father. So Temujin is who? MA Truth is dropping his drop. So when we talk about Temujin, where we at? Whom Temujin loathed for reasons both personal. So Temujin is Genghis Khan, alright? Who this blogger right here is calling the foster son of Prestigeon. So Temujin, alright, let's get it. Yesugye, Temu's father. So we're talking about Genghis Khan's father. His biological father, Yesugye, stole his bride from the Merkit. So... he stole, okay. All right, let's go. So Genghis Khan's dad, Yesugye, stole his bride, which would be, I guess, Genghis Khan's mom. So Genghis Khan's mom was stolen by Yesugye. She was a Merkit, or she stole his bride from the Merkit. So she was this Merkit, a forest people. She was from a forest people. Most likely connected to the same Carians. Alright, but let's go. So other positions. So these aren't the same Carians and Merkits, but these are the forest people. These are not the same here. I want to make a distinction between the Carians and the Merkits. But the Merkits specifically were the forest people south of Baikal. All right, so Genghis Khan's mother was from the forest people south of Baikal. All right, so his father, Yesugye, stole his bride from the Merkit, a favor they returned by stealing Temujin's wife, Borte. So then Genghis Khan's wife was stolen. Just like Yesugye stole his bride from the Merkit, then the Merkit returned the favor by stealing Temujin or Genghis Khan's wife, Borte. So this is their family situation. This was their family affair. So Yesugye of the Borjigid Mongol clan. Alright, so that's a specific clan. Good Mongols, bad Mongols. Clan, tribe. Tribes of Israel, tribe. Clan met his end poisoned by the Tartars. After his death, the Mongols under the rival Talchigud clan left Temujin's family to fend for themselves. Only after years of hardship was Temujin able to reconstitute his father's following. In this, he was aided by his father's brother, his father's blood brother, or Anda. So Genghis Khan, when he needed help, he went to his father's blood brother. So his father's brother would be his blood uncle, or Ande, Togrul Khan of the Karayid. We're talking about now Togrul Khan. We're talking about Prester John. As Togrul Khan is Hong Kong, is Prester John. Togrul Khan of the Karayid. Alright, so we're going to get into this Karayid. We'll get that spelling of it. Borte had brought with her a wedding gift, a sable coat for Temujin's family, but he devised a better use for it. He presented it to Togrul Khan. In accepting the coat, Togrul Khan agreed to treat Temujin as his own son and protected him as such. Alright, let's back it up. So Borte is Genghis Khan's wife, who they stole back from Temujin or Genghis Khan. So Temujin is the wife. Borte. Temujin's wife, Borte. So Borte had brought with her a wedding gift when she was stolen, a sable coat. So on top of Genghis Khan's wife being stolen, he also sent a sable coat for Temujin's family. Oh, all right. Let's read this right. Cause I know this is kind of, all right. Let's get it just like this. So Borte brought from Karayid, from Togrul Khan, from Prester John, back to Genghis Khan a sable coat as a wedding gift. Alright. For Temujin's family, for Genghis Khan's family. So whatever this sable coat is, it must be something dope. Trust me, it's not just a coat. But he devised a better use for, he presented it to Togrul Khan. In accepting the coat, Togrul Khan agreed to treat Temujin. So this must be some insight they had. He has his own son. So now Togrul Khan or Prester John agrees to treat Temujin as his own son and protect him as such. This was a time when the Chinese Qin dynasty was particularly annoyed with the Tartars. So now we have these Chinese Qins, and this is the reason why China why this Qinna. Alright. We're going to get into this, and we're going to get into some more OSB, man, OSB, to get into this Qin too, and with the origin of this Qinna, what they're calling, you know, but, alright, so we got these Tartars, these Qinna, Karayid and Mongol joined the Qin in defeating the Tartars. The Tartar 1202, in gratitude, Togrul Khan was given the Chinese title Wang, Prince. Which was soon corrupted in Mongol speech to Hong Kong. Alright. So, all this is what we got to get into to connect where we're going right now. Because I know you thought Prester John was just talking about the Americas and this. And we got into the Indians, into the Asians, into the Chinese Qin, into the different sects of Mongols, to the Karayids. And which Tartars are we talking about? Which Tartars did Karayid help defeat? Which Tartars, you know what I'm saying, were rocking for you? Which Tartars were rocking against you? So one Tartar is not all Tartars. One Mongol is not all Mongol. But now we have this 1202 day. Togrul Khan was given the Chinese title Wang Prince, which was soon corrupted in Mongol speech to Ong. Wang, Prince Khan, Prince Ong. Ong is Wang, which means Prince. Ong, Prince Khan. Togrul is Prince Khan, Ong. Alright, now check it. Togrul Ong Khan, Prince Khan, was in fact a Nestorian, Christian. Uh-oh. But we know old King renowned for wise counsel. Fathers Anda notwithstanding, Genghis fell out with him soon after the Tartar campaign, after Toghrul rejected a proposal to wed his son and daughter to Genghis's children. So even though he said, I'll treat you like my own son, even though you're my foster son, but you're my blood brother's son, I'll still treat you as my own son. Then this Genghis Khan, this Temujin, still he wanted to wed his Toghrul rejected a proposal to wed his son and daughter to Genghis's children. So Genghis wanted all their children to marry and be one, and he said, I just took you in, man, but I'm not gonna wed my children to your children. The rift between them grew until war broke out in 1203 when Temujin attacked Jamukha for the title of Khan. So now the title, Temujin attacked Jamukha for the title of Khan. This is when the hijack happened. This is when the Khan that you see today, publicized today, became Khan. Even though he don't look like that, he's still melanated. But this is the hijack right here in 1203. Toghrul, fearing Temujin's growing power, plotted with Jamukha to have Temujin assassinated. Toghrul Khan was killed, so Prestigeon was killed. If this theory is accurate, we're just surfing it. We're going to keep digging on it, but how do you like that? All right, so Toghrul Khan, Prestigeon was killed in 1203, this person is saying, by naming soldiers who failed to recognize him as the former. So he's saying that they were killed by these soldiers who failed to recognize him as the former were fleeing from a defeat by Genghis Khan, as Genghis Khan. So as they were fleeing, as these soldiers were fleeing, they failed to recognize Prestigeon and killed him, according to this particular. You know, I haven't heard about any other ways that Prestigeon died, so. Genghis captured, alright, so. Then he captured the daughter, Becky, a daughter of Toghrul's brother, Jakku Gambol, and married her to his son, Toloi. They had several children, including Mange, Kublai, that's the whole Marco Polo situation. Kublai, Hulago, so they married into Prestigeon's family by force. Now, you know we're just talking about Prestigeon. So when you marry into Prestigeon's family, even though they were already this complexion, now you see the foolishness of this Marco Polo situation, having them out like looking like modern day Chinese Mongols, when in reality, it's all code word for you. Alright. So let's get back to the sister MA Truth is dropping with the Carriots. Carriots. Alright, so we're relating that to Toghrul on Prestigeon again. We're only talking Prestigeon. William of Rubric says a certain Voot, Lord of the Carried, brother to the Nestorian king Prestigeon, was defeated by the Mongols under Genghis, and that Genghis made off with Voot's daughter and married her to his son. So we're talking about Prestigeon, brother to the Nestorian king Prestigeon. So the Lord of the Carrier is his brother. We're only talking about the kingdom. We're only talking about King David. We're only talking about Solomon. But this is how they change names and places, just like your parallel times and histories tells you they do. You know, they're projecting different things into the BCs that are really just taking place at the same time, but they have different historians writing about it in different languages, giving them different titles, and sometimes they put them in different places. But now we can decipher and see which fits. What fits what we've been building? We have a perspective too. We have a theory. We have theories. It's okay here to have theories. So what have we been building? Go back in the drop and tell us. And see if you're surfing that. And see if it fits into what we've been building here. Independently. And together. and that Genghis made off with Wu's daughter and married her to his son, which upon produced Mangke, the Khan at the time of the William's writing. According to Marco Polo's travel, the war between the Prester John and Genghis Khan started when Genghis, ruler of the rebellious Tartars. So there were rebellious Tartars. There were rebellious Mongols, rebellious Tartars, rebellious Negroes. Asked for the hand of Prester John's daughter in marriage, angered that his lowly vassal. That's how we saw Genghis Khan and his seed. Now, according to this guy, that you know, they had the blood brother connection, their fathers, but you know, we got to put all of it together. That could be accurate. I don't know. I wasn't there. I don't know if Prester John is the blood uncle of Genghis Khan or just the foster father of Genghis Khan, but clearly they're related in these families, and this is a family affair with weddings taking place back and forth. And in this case, not taking place back and forth. Prester John denied him in no uncertain terms, drawn to the quick. Genghis challenged Prester John. He challenged Prester John. And in the war that followed, Prester John perished. So was Prester John taken out by Genghis Khan? When we call him the Great Khan, are we saying that he's the actual Great Khan? And this is the Khan that literally just recently took over. When Temujin, or Genghis Khan, attacked Jammu for the title of Khan. So what my sister is kicking with this chariot, what we're getting out this Genghis Khan, his conquest, his empire, his legacy. We say perhaps, surprisingly, given his genocidal record with the Tartars, and Merkid, Temujin, Genghis Khan, did not order a general massacre of the Kuryat aristocracy. He knew many of them personally, and both sides accepted that the conflict had been unnecessary, a product of Ilka's pride and ambition of integral Prester John. One more time. The rebellious Tartars asked for the hand. All right, let's get it right here. Below, we camp at the Tuo River. Remember the Tuo River, where the ghost of Togrul Ong, which is what Prince Prester John, which is all titles of Prince and King Khan, still treads. Alright. So all that is one of the same. So again, we see Togrul's weakness. So they're calling him weak. This author is calling him, he had a, you know, as a product of his weakness. This was a very different matter from Tartars and Merkit. So we got to get this in context. I know they ain't calling my man Prester John weak. I know they ain't calling him Prester John. They must be talking about a certain situation. So anyway, this was a very different matter from Tartars and Merkit. Whom Temujin, or Genghis Khan, loathed, he hated, for reasons both personal and to do with tribal revenge. He incorporated all of the most talented Kuryat military officers into his army. An admirer of General Quadah Bajatur, he spared his life on condition that he devote himself to the widow and children of the recently dead here in Kuildar. Always well informed, Temujin, Genghis Khan, knew which of Togrul's advisors had merely been doing their duty and which of them shared Ilka's hatred and detestation. Right. So he detested his ass, man. All right, I'm not a genius, I'm not a genie in the Bible. Detestation. He detested the Mongol. So he wanted to know which one of Prester John's peoples, you know, was really loyal to him, or did he, you know, which one of them was suckers. On this basis, he pardoned Quadog, one of Togrul's inner circle, but executed Kokochu, So he's executing Prestonjohn's people right in front of your face after he took over and killed Prestonjohn, apparently. But executed Kokochu, officially the Aung Khan's equerry, but really more of a boon companion, really more of a homie, right? Aung Khan. This is a separate substantiating resource, man. Togro Aung Prestonjohn Khan. Togro Aung Prestonjohn Khan. We're just talking about Prestonjohn, El Prestonjohn, Emperador de los Abyssinios. Abyssinia, Ethiopia. Man, M.A. Truth got the drop for this, man. Real spill. So he pardoned one of Prestonjohn's people. He executed another one. Aung Khan, alright. So Temujin ascended the Caryat throne in a formal capacity. A ceremony announced that henceforth Caryat and Mongol would be one nation. So now he's marrying into the Israelite blood. He's marrying into the Raja Haraja blood. Raja Haraja. Prestonjohn. He's marrying into Solomon, what they call Jewish King of Telmas, Jewish King of Tahama, Exilarch, David, Sauslin of Babylon and Georgia. These were all the sons of Raja Haraja Chola. You see how the India and the Indies are leading us back to it, man. Alright. So, let me get this last part here. We'll keep it pushing. So now they're one nation, right? What do they tell you today? We're one. They're assimilating into us. Why did Temujin defeat Togro when on paper the Caryat ruler had greater numbers? So we're talking about Prestonjohn. Greater resources and better political contact. There can be many instances. Togro was both weak and cruel. A treacherous fratricide who was indecisive and unable to think things through. Half a dozen moves ahead like a chess player. The ability Temujin possessed with a vast quantity to spare. Fitful, cowardly, vacillating. Togro allowed himself to be made a fool of by Jamuga. Wow, so you see someone just going in on my man Prester. Clearly they have another perspective of Prestonjohn. They're calling him weak and, you know, treacherous. Whatever this is, fratricide. Indecisive, unable to think things through. It doesn't move like a chess player. Sound like someone is just trying to assassinate the character of my man Prestonjohn. And my sister M.A. Truth caught that. She said, nah, someone's talking slick over here about Prestonjohn. But let's see if they have any babies in this backwater. I think we got some already. So after they keep talking shit, his weakness and indecisiveness, all that stuff. His weakness particularly manifested itself towards his son, whom he should have slapped down decisively for reasons of state. Instead, he allowed a father's weakness to decide the future of the Caryat. Okay. So what they're calling weak, he's saying that he should have, destroyed his own son, you know. But his father's weakness to not destroy his own son, his lovingness, his trustworthiness, they're calling weakness. So you see how the hijack is talking. Oh, the hijack's always talking shit. But we'll get the babies out like we say we will, right? So father's weakness to decide the future of Caryat. So because he loved his son, the weakness of love. It is unlikely there was much merit in his claim that he gave in to his son to prevent rebellion and civil war in his kingdom. So there's not much merit that he gave, merit in the claims that he gave in to his son to prevent rebellion and civil war in the kingdom. So there's not much merit. unlikely there was not much merit in his claim that he gave in to his son to prevent rebellion. So they're saying that he claims he gave in to his son to prevent rebellion and civil war. Now, when he's talking about his son, are they just referring to Temujin? Right? So they're talking about the foster son who they took in as his son. And because he could have cut Genghis a long time ago, they're saying that the only reason he was defeated, on paper he had him beat, but he let him win because he loved his son. And it was a weakness, a father's weakness. Temujin was far more intelligent than the Hong Kong. Oh, okay. Let me see the paperwork on that to show this IQ test. Or is this another perspective of a hater? Was a better politician and had more disciplined army and more efficient system of intelligence and espionage. So, you know, he had more tricks up his sleeve. But one of the Caryat grandees he spared was Togrul's brother, Jaka Gambu, who later turned out to have been one of his reliable spies at the Caryat court. So he turned snitch on the Caryats. Alright. Moreover, Togrul suffered heavily from desertations and defections, both before the decisive battle and before the 3-day encounter at Jeju. Alright, so man, you know, I could tell this is dry as we go into it, man. But thanks so much to our wonderful sister M.A. True for that outside validation of this Temujin Togrul relationship, this family affair that's going on. Alright, so now we got some of that. Make sure I bookmark this so I can come back to it, you know, again. Alright, we got our, we understand we're only talking about the copper color races that were found here by the Europeans, so we understand what we're talking about here. We understand that this is the document that enslaved us here, because we're only talking about the islands. We're only talking about the Indies and Indias and the Prestigeon of the three Indias. Alright, and if you're enjoying this this little background music, man, y'all can check out this right there on the drop, man. Spanish guitar favorites, man. Remember, this is all your shit. This is all your shit. This is all your shit. So check it out and enjoy. And let me jump back into the Cholas, because we're only just talking Raja here, Raja Chola. The Chola dynasty went into decline at the beginning of the 13th century with the rise of the Pandyan dynasty. Which unfortunately caused their downfall. Interesting. Alright, the Chola dynasty. Raja Haraja Chola. Went into decline at the bottom of the 1200s with the rise of the Pandyan dynasty. So how did this rise affect the Cholas? The Cholas left a lasting legacy. Their patronage of Tamil literature, so we gotta get into this Tamil literature, and their zeal in the building of temples has resulted in some great works of Tamil literature and architecture. The Chola kings were avid builders, mound builders, and envisioned the temples in their kingdoms not only as places of worship, but also as centers of economic activity. Timbuktu, Mansa Musa. If the Catalan's depiction of the Mansa Musa seems strangely to coincide and vibrate with the 14th century wish for an African Prestigeon, Fernandez and Maestro reminds us that in the 14th century, Mali projected an enthralling image for European gold hunters. It was the gold that particularly appealed to the Mediterranean public. So abundant is the gold which is found in this country, said the Catiline Atlas of Mali's ruler, that this lord is the richest and noblest king in all the land. The richest and noblest king in all the land. We're just talking about Prester John. The Cholas left a lasting legacy. Alright. So, you know, dig more into the Cholas. But we know we have a lot to dig in there. I want to keep going for now. Remember the Pandian dynasty that got us started. We got into the Tamil dynasties, the Chola and the Chera. Alright, so we got to see how this Chera is different than the Chola. Alright. They say we're an ancient Dravidian dynasty of the Tamil dynasty who ruled part of the present-day Tamil Nadu and Kerala, India, together with the Chola and the Pandians. They formed the three principal warring Iron Age kingdoms, medieval Iron Age kingdoms of southern India, known as Three Crown Kings of Talamakam. Man, if this ain't interesting, I don't know what it is. But you know, as we get into this Hindu India and this Brahma, this Abraham, Tamalakam, home of Tamil, refers to the geographic region inhabited by the ancient Tamil people. Tamalakam covered today Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Puducherry, Lakshadweep, however you say that, in southern parts of Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. The ancient Tamil country was divided into kingdoms. The best known among these were Cheras, Cholas, Pandians, and Pallavas. Right. Archaeological data from the prehistoric Kerala, Tamil Nadu appears to challenge the notion of separate culture region. So it's all one thing. During the Sangam period, Tamil culture began to spread outside Talamakam. Ancient Tamil settlements were also found in Sri Lanka. Right, so we're hearing about this again. It's Sri Lanka. Approximately during 350 BC 200, Tamilakam was ruled by three Tamil dynasties, Chola dynasty. Right. There were also a few independent chieftains, the Velas, during the time of the Maurya Empire in North India. So the Mauryas in North India, the Cheras, the Pandians, and Cholas were in late megalithic phase on the west coast of Talamakam. So they were building megaliths. The earliest datable references to the Tamil kingdom are inscriptions of the 3rd century BC during the Maurya Empire. Okay. Chola dynasty ruled 3 BC into 13. So, whatever the rise of this Pandian eventually took out the Chola. And again, when we get to the Cholas, you understand we're talking about Raja here, Raja Chola the First. Under Raja Hiraja Chola I and his successors. You got everybody else. You're talking about the pops of Prester John, Raja Hiraja Chola II. You're talking about the Indias, the Pandian. Alright, the Tamil dynasties. You're talking about the Exilarch. Like it says right here, his son was an Exilarch. Father of Exilarch David Soslin of Babylon and Georgia. Why does it say Babylon again? Because as we get right here, Exilarch, plural, the leader of the Jews of the Babylonian exile. So we're specifically talking about an exile, being exiled or separated, a captivity. The leader of the Jews during this time of the specific Babylonian exile. they were calling exilarchs. All right, so the term applied by Greeks to the head of the community of Jews in the diaspora when? During the Babylonian exile. So this exilarch estimated before 1302. Before 1302. So we're still talking 1200s. Same shit, people. So this is the king of the Israelites during the Babylonian exile, which is why they're calling him this, of Babylon and Georgia. And Georgia is just Asia or Russia or the same Akkadian, you know, Mongol, certain tribe of Mongol situation. What they call and title these things, Mongols and Negroes and this, that, and that. Alright, son of Rajarajachola II. Alright. And Lady Hannah of Babylon. So Lady Hannah is the wife of Prester John. Isn't that something? He's the father of Hasdi. So he became exilarch. His son became the next leader of the Jews during his captivity. Alright. And again, his mother is Prester John's wife. And they call her Lady Hannah of Babylon, wife of Rajarajachola II. Alright. Mother of Solomon. Mother of all these exilarchs. I mean, so this was a great woman we're talking about here. A powerful sister we're talking about here. We're only talking exilarchs. And I'm sorry, I forgot to leave the links last time. I'll make sure I leave all these so you can dig in all these, so you can look on this whole exilarch list. Alright, it says there's no definitive list of exilarchs, but this one seems to at least have been the result of a great deal of work, and it does acknowledge gaps and uncertainties further. It compares to the pedigree prepared by Alexander Good. Alright. So this is all his work. You can check it out, which is indicated in red. All the exilarchs shown in that pedigree are included by David Hughes, though some of the dates are slightly different. So that's just some of their drop, and then they start dropping it. Start with the first dynasty. Make sure you can see all that. Let me go here a little bit. Sometimes, you know, my joints start slipping here. Whoa! Y'all got to see me, man. I'm rocking Drop Nation at all time, man. I got the books rocking at all time, man. That's a sneak peek. Yeah. We at you, man. We at you, baby. I love y'all, man. Drop Nation, man. Alright. Here we go. That's just to wake your asses up. Almost. Sorry, Thing's tripping. Tripping. I just want to make sure y'all can see. That's all I'm trying to do. And it's just Jam Up Jones season. I think we good. Then y'all can see. Alright. Alright. Let's go. Let's go. Had to make a cameo on y'all, man. Let y'all know that I ain't play. Ain't play, play. Eli Sheep. So that's first dynasty. Jehoiakim, Jeconiah, king of Judah, Jehoiakim. Alright, so you can, you know, follow these, you know, bring your sword out, man, and look up these names, man, and research all these dynasty names. Again, these are the exilarchs. These are the, you know, leaders of the Jews of Babylonian exile, and of course those that are, you know, obviously it's the full king's, you know, list. So we're talking about the entire lineage when we talk about this. We're talking about the king's list when we're talking about this. First dynasty, king's list. You know what I'm saying? Alright. So match this up with, you know, this Babylonian captivity, what's going on, line of David, David, Nathan, Matatha, Menah, Menah, Melia, Eliaki. All right, so that was a surprise. I brought out the Eliakim in 2 Kings, but you know how you see it's lining up here. It says Tamar, the dynasty's heiress, by the former husband Prince Nerjah, something like that, was reckoned the royal Davidic heir after the death of the late King Jehoiakim, and numbered the second exilarch. Line of descendant of King David is David, Nathan, Matatha. So these are the line of the descendants of King David. Menah, Messiah, Meleah, Eliakim or Eliakim, Eliakim, Jonan, Joseph, Jude, Simeon, Levi, Zerubbabel, something like that, son of two. All right, man. So I'm not going to go through all the names, but you see what's on there. It's a pretty amazing list. And again, it goes all the way down to the Azariah, Hezekiah, you know. All these titles that were, you know, basically passed all the way through the 1200s, all the way to 1270. And it continues. Is this play play? Is this play play? Second dynasty, first dynasty, third dynasty. Third dynasty up into 1401. Up into 1401. So-called Negro. What did Columbus mean when he said he was coming here to capture Jerusalem? They're calling you copper colored race. I mean, have you figured it out yet for yourselves? Have you figured out what it all means for yourself? You gotta figure this shit out for yourself. You know, we can only lead you to water. I can only lead you to water. You can only lead me to water. Now. You remember this link last time? The mythical journey to Rome of a certain Patriarch John. Prestigeon, Patriarch John of India, 1122. 1122. I mean, just out of curiosity, how would that line up? On this little list, 1122. Ah, that will bring us right here under David. Who they're calling David the Third. I guess born of Hezekiah the Third. So this would be the son of Hezekiah, also called David. So in this theory, maybe we can flow with that. This Prestigeon is a direct lineage of this Davidic line. Or is he the actual thing? Is he actually the King David? Is he the direct exilarch? Direct descendant of this David. And they're bringing this right here. And if I'm just following these dates, 1122, boom, David, third. So we have David matching up with this Prestigeon, who's also called. Prestigeon is also called Lebna Dango de Wheat. Who the Portuguese contemporary simplified it to David, young David, like his namesake and alleged ancestor, David. 1110 to 1130, David the Third, born of Hezekiah. This is just separate substantiating research from Peerage, peerage.org, genealogy, Exilarch. So, David, 1122, and visited, you know, and his visit to Callistus II cannot have been the origin of the legend. Alright, so we got this. We got to back into the Nestorians. I want to get right back to where we're at. Let's just jump into it. King David is no other than the Mongolian conqueror, Genghis, however you want to call it, Genghis Khan. So, I'm asking you, is he the foster father of Genghis? Is he, you know what I'm saying, the blood uncle of Genghis? And Genghis overtook his uncle for the title of Khan? Is King David Genghis Khan? This researchers think so. King David is no other than the Mongolian conqueror Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan, who at this time, with three legions, pushed forward towards the west, and in a most sanguinary battle, annihilated the power of Islam. So this King David was annihilating the power of Islam. All this situation was getting, you know, even certain sects or tribes of the Tartars. Okay, so in Central Asia, he and many of his successors were favorable to the Christians. Why? Because they were annihilating the power of Islam. So the Christians tried to recruit them, and now they call him a Nestorian Christian because he's related to an old king who is renowned for wise counsel, which is who? Solomon. Nestor, named for old king renowned for wise counsel. So when you see Nestorian, just remember the etymology. And I'm not saying that this Nestor was this, was that. I'm saying this is how they play with the names and titles. And when you go into the etymology, all they're really saying is that he's related to or of the old king who's renowned for wisdom. Who's renowned for wisdom? Renown means it's popular, right? Renowned for wisdom. Renown, fame, reputation. Who's famous for being wise? Who's famous for being a wise king? Who's the most famous wise king you can think of? Go. Who's the most famous wise king you could think of? Would it be Solomon? He's of Solomon. Would it be Solomon? Well, which one you want to choose? Is he of this Solomon here in 730? Is he of, you know what I'm saying? He's of the line. This king is of an old king renowned for wise counsel. So they're calling him and hiding him in the name Nestor. But this author is saying that King David is Genghis Khan, annihilating the power of Islam, favorable to the Christians for that reason, and averse to the Mohammedans. The Mongol kingdom was surpassed all Asiatic principalities, the dumb diverses, subjugate even their principalities by its display. But the name David given to the Eastern conquerors still remains unexplained. Alright. So we didn't stop there last time, right? Oh, we're back in the chariot. So we're gonna, now that we got some Nestor drop, let's go. The horrible slaughter committed by the Mongols soon proved that they were no pious pilgrims bound for the Holy Sepulchre. Still less were they Christians. After a short time, the legend assumed another form. So the horrible slaughter committed by the Mongols, all right, by this King David, saying, oh, it's proved that they could not just be righteous people bound for holiness. No way. Because this is from the perspective of the favorable Christians. Still less were they Christians. No, they were Nestorians, right? After a short time, the legend assumed another form. It said that the Mongolians were the wild hordes mentioned in Presbyter's letter to Manuel. They had risen up against their own ruler, King David. Oh. So first, we're saying that King David is no other than the Mongolian conqueror, Genghis Khan. And now we're saying that it is said that the Mongolians were the wild hordes mentioned in the Prester John's letter to Manuel. So it's separating a tribe of these Mongolians. They had risen up against their own ruler, King David. Now, when did this happen in the scripture? If we're talking about the actual King David, and we're just talking about projections and timelines, I mean, when did they rise up against King David? Murdering both him and his father. They had risen up against their own ruler, King David, murdering both him and his father. Is this another addition to what we know, what we don't know? Is this something completely separate? It's okay either way. But we know we're talking about a lineage. At least we can agree on that. Whether it's the actual David or Solomon, or the actual lineage that was recently destroyed recently by the invasion. And now someone else is taking your titles here. The Speculum Historiae of Vincent of Beauvais says that in the year of our Lord 1202, their Lord 1202, after murdering their ruler David, the Tartars. Oh, so we're talking about the Tartars. All right, Mongols, Tartars, this, that. All these fucking titles are crazy, right? But we're just talking about Tartars. Remember the Tartars that Taku Khan had to, went up against. And then they got the rebellious Tartars and this. So after murdering their ruler David, the Tartars, or rebellious Tartars, set about destroying the people. Certain historical facts form the basis of this remarkable report. Bar Hebraeus mentions that in 1006, the Mongolian tribe of the Caryids, we talked about the Caryids again in Upper Asia, had become Christians Nestorians of the line of old kings renowned for wise counsel. Back to the Caryids, back to Togrul Khan, back to Prester John. So all we're talking about now is another relation to these Mongols and to these Caryids of Upper Asia. All these are Mongols. All these are melanated people. And then when you have your tribes of those that are connected to the specific line of David, you have other tribes that might be other lines of Israel and other tribes that might be outside of that, such as Moab, or just like Zelia S. Bay signed in the Treaties of the Moors in 1470. Something, but you can look it up. It's right there in the links below. Click on it. Click on the Morris Treaty, where she is signing as an Israel, as a Moabite. So why is Zelia S. Bay signing as a Moabite, signing for her land as a Moabite here in America under a Morris Treaty, and she's signing, and under her name says Moab. So what other, lineages are we talking about? What other Tartar languages? What other Esau languages? What other? It's all Jacob and Esau, but it's all different titles for Jacob and Esau. All melanated things. Mongols are thrown around there. Tartars are thrown around there. Tartaria, according to the account of Rubiques, the Franciscan, these Caryids were related to the Namans, another Mongol shepherd tribe, shepherd kings, and paid tribute to their ruler Korchan. They also were Nestorian Christians of this line of kings of old wisdom, wise, famous for wise counsel, famous for wisdom, and in that vicinity were considered the countrymen of Prester John. And in that vicinity were considered the countrymen of Prester John. The prince of the Caryids, Ong Khan, was in 1202 completely subject to the superior power of Genghis Khan, who meanwhile was on the friendliest terms with his family, thus giving the Caryids a certain amount of independence. Marco Polo speaks of Ong Khan as the great prince who is called Prester John. So that is Aung Khan. So again, the prince of the Caryats, Aung Khan, which is Prester John, was in 1202. Excuse me, 1202. Man, it's a lot of drop, a lot of reading. Was in 1202 completely subject to the superior power of Genghis Khan. So now they're separating. First he says this is Genghis Khan. Now this person says that in 1202 was completely subject to the superior power of Genghis Khan, who meanwhile was on the friendliest terms with his family. So Genghis Khan is saying was on the friendly terms with his family, thus giving the Caryats a certain amount of independence. Marco Polo speaks of Aung Khan as the great prince who is called Prester John. The whole world speaking of his great power. His great power. The last noble image of the Negro and his great power and his kingdom that was taken out by the dumb diverses in the invasions of those that considered him the enemies of Christ. Because they tried to... convert him. They tried to, use this guy, use our kingdom against their Islam issue. They tried to recruit us and then label us Nestorian Christians to hijack us for them because they wanted us to be with them. So now when you read Nestorian, Nestor, and you see, oh, even King David is called a Christian when he's an Israelite with law and order. Then you see the hijack. And you see you're only talking about Prester John. So I wanted to get into this link a little bit more, but I'll leave it. These are all great links that we got to get into for part 14. We talk about the Hebrew letters give no indication of the identifying Prester John with the ruler of Ethiopia.